MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram COVID-19 update. It's been a few days since we did one, and I've been busy in the intensive care unit taking care of COVID-19 patients. And one of the things that has struck me in taking care of those patients is that while there is respiratory issues on the ventilator, it seems as though the biggest issue that we're dealing with is in the cardiovascular realm. It seems as though a lot of the patients that I'm taking care of are succumbing to cardiovascular complications such as myocardial infarction or blood clots, rather than the inability to ventilate. And we'll talk more about that later. But we are at nearly 3 million total confirmed cases, although the numbers seem as though they're probably much higher than that based on the epidemiological studies that we're now doing with antibody testing. In the United States, we're at nearly 1 million cases, and it seems as though the daily new cases in the United States have plateaued. And in terms of daily deaths, it's too early to tell whether or not we're having a decline. In Canada, 46,000 cases and 2,500 deaths. Also in Canada, daily new cases seem to have plateaued. And again, too early to tell whether or not daily deaths are coming down. In the United Kingdom, 150,000 coronavirus cases. Daily new cases over there seem to have plateaued as well. Again, still too early to tell whether or not the number of daily deaths are coming down. In Australia, almost 7,000 cases and 83 deaths. Here, the daily new cases have definitely come down, and we're watching very carefully to see whether or not the onset of fall and winter will bring about a recurrence in Australia. I know there were a lot of questions last time about hydroxychloroquine and the review that we did on a number of the trials, and the questions were related to why zinc was not included in the trials. For those of you who are interested, in the intensive care unit that I work in, we use hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin and zinc supplementation. And I would add that in the intensive care unit, we are seeing the sickest of patients that are coming in. And so far, our outcomes are not very different than those that we presented from the JAMA article a few updates ago. But what I really want to get to is this disturbing article that was put in the Washington Post. Young and middle-aged people barely sick with COVID-19 are dying of strokes. Doctors sound alarm about patients in their 30s and 40s left debilitated or dead. Some didn't even know they were infected. And they talk about how this patient came into the hospital and had a stroke, and they were trying to remove the clot using the technology that they have. And it says here that he observed something that he had never seen before. On the monitors, the brain typically shows up as a tangle of black squiggles, like a can of spaghetti, he said, that provide a map of blood vessels. A clot shows up as a blank spot, and he used the needle device to pull the clot out. He saw new clots forming in real time around it. And the question is why is that happening? They mention in the article that many researchers suspect strokes in COVID-19 patients may be direct consequence of blood problems that are producing clots all over some people's bodies. They're mentioning here that they've taken care of patients in their 30s with stroke and COVID, and this was extremely surprising, he said. Many doctors expressed worry that as the New York City Fire Department was picking up four times as many people who died at home as normal during the peak of infection, that some of the dead had suffered sudden strokes. The truth may never be known because few autopsies were conducted. So finally, someone is trying to do some research. Dr. Chow is hoping to answer such questions through a review of strokes and other neurological complications in these COVID-19 patients. There was an interesting case study in thrombosis research that was accepted only a couple of weeks ago. And it goes through and talks about an interesting case, a case which is not unusual and one that I have seen many times in the intensive care unit with COVID-19. So this is a 72-year-old, otherwise healthy male, apparently. And 6 days after admission to the hospital, the patient started to decompensate and went into ARDS, acute renal insufficiency, and had altered level of consciousness, which required the patient to need to go to the intensive care unit. One of the things that they measured was something called a D-dimer. And on that first day, the D-dimer was 0.69, which is just barely elevated. But 4 days later, it was 2.55. 11 days into it, it went to 2.81. 21 days later, it was 20.63. And this is pretty high. And this is actually what I've been seeing in my COVID-19 patients as well. Then at day 24, came back down. We'll talk about what happened on day 21. Because when they started to see these numbers rising in a D-dimer, what that usually means is that there's some sort of coagulation occurring. So what you have to understand is that in the blood vessels are coated with tiny cells that are very flat called endothelium. And these tiny cells that are very flat have on their surface receptors and enzymes. And in this case, it's ACE-2. And so the virus can actually attack this ACE-2. We'll talk more about that later. But if there is inflammation that's occurring here in the endothelial cells, just below the endothelial surface is a collection of something called von Willebrand's factor. And von Willebrand's factor can be released when there's damage to the endothelium. And in the lumen of the blood vessel is factor 8, which is one of the active factors that converts factor 10 into the active form of factor 10A. It can get confusing talking about coagulation factors, but the key that I want you to understand is that von Willebrand's factor is subendothelial, and it can get into circulation, and it is a procoagulant. So when they went and measured here on day 21, what the measurement of von Willebrand's factor was, it was actually at 520% of what it normally should be. And when they measured factor 8, it was 369% of what it should be. So what they started at that point here was unfractionated heparin. This is an anticoagulant. This is something that inhibits the body's ability to coagulate. And when they did that, the D-dimer levels then dropped by day 24 to 6.26. And finally, by day 29, it dropped down to 1.94. The other thing that they noticed was here, they started noticing positive IgM antibodies for anti-cardiolipin antibody and also positive for anti-beta 2 glycoprotein, even though the IgGs were negative, indicating an acute antibody. Now, it's interesting to note that they switched to unfractionated heparin. When the patient was first admitted, the patient was started on a prophylactic dose of dalteparin at around 5,000 units sub-Q daily. So it seems as though these blood clots may be mediated by very high levels of von Willebrand's factor and even factor 8 in the coagulation cascade. And why is this happening? It may be related to endothelial activation from inflammation that's going on and release of this von Willebrand's factor, which binds factor 8 in the lumen of the blood vessel. So why is all of this happening? It may be happening because the virus is taking out ACE2. Number one, because it's binding to ACE2. But number two, it may be taking it out because as it binds to ACE2, it's now rendering that enzyme completely inactive. Now, remember what we talked about back in update 37, where we talked about what happens with ACE2 in relation to angiotensinogen and angiotensin 1 and angiotensin 2. Let's review that real quickly. Remember, we said that angiotensinogen is converted by renin into angiotensin 1, and then angiotensin 1 is converted into angiotensin 2 by the enzyme ACE, just regular ACE. This is where ACE inhibitors are used. So if you have angiotensin 2 in low levels, remember that ACE2 will take these angiotensin 2 levels that are low and convert it into angiotensin 1-7. Angiotensin 1-7 is actually a vasodilator, and it reduces inflammation. However, when the virus, this pink thing, comes in, and binds to ACE-2, it now no longer can convert angiotensin 2 into angiotensin 1-7. And instead, what you get is vasoconstriction because you have high levels of angiotensin 2, and you have vasoconstriction, increased blood pressure, increased vascular permeability, pulmonary edema, and ARDS. In other words, in order to keep your angiotensin 2 levels under good control and prevent vasoconstriction, you need ACE-2. When the virus binds ACE-2 and degrades it, it takes it out of circulation, and what you're left with is a bunch of vasoconstricting angiotensin 2 levels that can cause oxidative stress. Now, here was a very interesting study that was published in 2008 looking at angiotensin-converting enzyme 2, or ACE-2, looking at the endothelial protection and what it does with atherosclerosis. So in this situation, they used mice, and they knocked out the ACE-2 gene to see what would happen. In this case, the ACE-2 knockouts would be as if the mice had been infected with the coronavirus and taken out their ACE-2 enzymes. And in this situation, they showed here that ACE-2 deficient mice exhibited impaired endothelium-dependent relaxation. In other words, they were constricting. It also talks about how they know that ACE-2 has been identified as a critical negative modulator of angiotensin 2 bioactivity, counterbalancing the effects of ACE. Here is, however, I think the most important statement of all, and that's the enzyme ACE-2, which is the target of SARS-CoV-2, COVID-19, attenuated angiotensins 2 induced reactive oxygen species production in part through decreasing the expression of P22 Fox. What they're saying here is that when ACE-2 is downregulated, it can no longer mitigate the effects of angiotensin 2 and specifically oxidative stress on the endothelium. So in other words, when the virus binds the endothelium, it takes out ACE-2, and now ACE-2 cannot prevent angiotensin 2, which is now reigning unrestrained, cannot prevent it from causing oxidative stress and more inflammation than would have normally been the case with just the infected cell to begin with. Finally, they conclude, these data indicate that ACE-2, in an angiotensin 1-7-dependent fashion, in other words, through angiotensin 1-7, functions to improve endothelial homeostasis via a mechanism that may involve attenuation of NADPH-OX-induced reactive oxygen species production. Now, let's just unpack that. NADPH oxidase is an enzyme that takes oxygen and adds an electron to it to make superoxide. Superoxide can damage cells very quickly, and it's used by neutrophils to kill bacteria. But there is also another version of NADPH oxidase, which is found in vascular cells. So in an infection with the SARS-CoV-2 virus, where you do not have the ACE-2 enzyme, you're going to have NADPH oxidase reigning unrestrained because there is no angiotensin 1-7. With that inflammation, you may have release of von Willebrand's factor, which will couple with factor 8 and form intra-arterial thromboses. And they state here that ACE-2-based treatment approaches may be a novel approach to limit aberrant vascular responses and atherothrombosis. So let's summarize what's going on. Here we have SARS-CoV-2, and what happens is when you breathe it in, it's going to go first to your lungs, and specifically, it's going to go to the ACE-2 receptor in your lungs. And what we all thought and imagined was that we were going to get ARDS, and that's why we started treating patients with hypoxia secondary to ARDS, because this is what we all were expecting for months and months. But the virus gets worse and spreads, and then it starts to go into the blood vessels. And the blood vessels inside of them also have ACE-2. And what happens is when it goes to ACE-2, now we have unopposed angiotensin 2, We have release of von Willebrand's factor and factor VIII, and so we get thrombosis. And with this happening, these things happen so quickly that before this ARDS has a chance to get bad enough to cause the H type of lung problem, we have thrombosis, which is causing the ground glass opacification, and we get the L type of lung problem. And the final common denominator in this process over here, which seems to be taking most of the patients in the intensive care unit, is a process known as oxidative stress. And as we'll show in the upcoming lectures and updates, the people with the worst oxidative stress from a baseline standpoint are those people with cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, and overweight. And these are exactly the same people who we see as having the largest risk of dying in COVID-19. What we have over here are the happy hypoxics. These are the patients that look like they're at high altitude, according to some emergency room physicians. These are the people who are having cardiovascular collapse and blood clots in their vessels. These are the ones that are put on ventilators, but to little avail. And so I think that an understanding of oxidative stress and how it might be involved with COVID-19 is going to be instructive, and it may give us some avenues for therapeutics. So if you like this video, click like. If you want to see more videos like this, make sure you click the subscribe button. And if you want to be notified when I get those videos done, then make sure you hit the bell button. And for more educational videos on demand, visit us at medcram.com. Thank you for joining us.